Minister of Finance wishes to make a statement on June. Point of order.
Speaker, Mr. Alistair has already alluded to this to a degree, but this morning the Assembly was given less than an hour to consider a 37-page statement on the monitoring round. In addition, as far as I'm aware, no committee has been given a detailed briefing before today's announcements. Any opportunity for scrutiny has been strangled by the DUP Sinn Féin executive, who appear genuinely terrified of genuine accountability. As such, understanding Order 16, I'm formally asking.
That is not a point of order. Now, if you have a point of order, then raise the point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Understanding Order 16, I'm formally asking for this item of business to be adjourned until next Monday, the 20th of June, to give parties time to actually consider the content of the statement.
I just think we need to take time to consider that. Can I just ask the member to clarify under which standing order he is making his request?
Mr. Speaker, it was standing order 16.
Standing order 16 refers to a debate. During any debate or any debate on a motion, this is not a debate, this is a statement by the minister. Therefore, standing order 16 does not apply. The Minister of Finance wishes to make a statement on June monitoring.
It was good to hear children's voices in the gallery earlier on. Occasionally we hear childish voices in the Assembly, perhaps from all sides, but certainly children's voices, I think, give us a great good lift to the day. I want to say to if you'll allow me, Mr. Speaker, in relation to Chris Lyttle's proposal, that in this monitoring round we will allocate $5 million for special educational needs, and I know that will cheer him and the parents who are with us today. I want to say that there have been two attempts, I think, to delay this statement, and there have been concerns about the style of the statement, the style of this monitoring round. I want to say to all my colleagues, this is what streamlined government looks like. This is what efficient government looks like. This is the earliest monitoring round presented to this Assembly. This, in my view, is a government which does, which delivers, and this is an indication of how we intend to do that in the time ahead. So take it, Cheann Comhairle and members, as a statement of intent to deliver for all our people. A Cheann Comhairle a boilam buíhas oir deitis an dhéis seo a hortu an raitis seo a cur a láthar an tionnal an iú. Is é seo an chéad waita manatarachta den trefs seo agus tuirthi na cúltaí fadjar nach anané agus bautaí a hui roin ar cúisina a bhíne hime ar bálbeg. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank you for affording me this opportunity to present this statement to the Assembly today. This is the first monitoring statement in this new mandate, and it will signal a marked departure, as members have noticed, from previous formats for reasons that I will explain shortly. At Cheann Comhairle, this monitoring round presented the new executive with a number of very significant challenges. Many of these challenges emanate from the austerity agenda that the Westminster Government is seeking to impose upon the devolved administrations. No doubt we will return to that later in the budget debate and rehearse some of the arguments yesterday about the Tories who have no mandate here and their wishes for our people and how we are going to assist those. That imposition of an austerity agenda is entirely unacceptable, and I will make best endeavours to prevent the least well-off from shouldering this burden. Despite the challenges, the Executive has been able to conclude this monitoring round without having to engage in a draconian cuts exercise, confounding, may I say, the predictions of the naysayers. At Cheann Comhairle, given the pressing need to bring clarity to departments and ministers on the 2016-17 in-year position so that they could get to work with the money I am allocating today, and in the interest of efficient governance, the Executive has agreed to my request to expedite the monitoring round through the urgent procedure mechanism. This is the earliest point at which any Finance Minister has announced the June monitoring outcome, and the quick conclusion of the process signals my intention and the intention of my ministerial colleagues to conclude business in a timely manner. I believe the next executive meeting will be at the very end of the month, and I think this is a much more efficient way to proceed for all the people we serve. Turning to the substantive issues within this monitoring round, Cheann Comhairle, let me begin by highlighting that the executive's deliberations have actually delivered many positive outcomes that citizens will warmly welcome. The allocations are a signal of intent as well. They show where our priorities lie. In terms of detail, the starting point for the June monitoring round has to be the outcome of the last year's provisional outturn. This determines how much money we have carried forward from the previous financial year into this monitoring round. I will therefore begin with the 2015-16 provisional outturn. Provisional outturn is critically important for the Executive. Not only does it provide a strong indication of departmental budget management performance during the last financial year, it also determines, Mr. Speaker, the amount of resources that the Executive can plan to carry forward through the Devolved Administration Budget Exchange Scheme, the BES. And detailing this position, as well as in relation to the June monitoring round, my focus will be on the non-ring-fence resource deal, as this is the element which funds our important public services. I will refer to this as resource deal for simplicity hereafter. I will touch on the non-cash ring-fence resource deal element, which is handled separately, since this is strictly controlled and cannot be used for any other purpose. Under the budget exchange scheme, the Executive may carry forward a limited level of underspend based on a percentage of the final budget for the year. For 2015-16, the limit of 0.6% resource deal equates to $59.5 million within the 1.5% capital deal limit, providing for up to $11.5 million, including ring-fence financial transactions capital FTC. Members should note that any underspends recorded above these amounts would be lost to the Executive. Before I turn to the amount the Executive has been able to carry forward, Mr. Speaker, I would first like to highlight the individual departmental position. So let me start with the departmental outcome. In their provisional outturn returns, the departments registered total underspends of $44.4 million for resource deal, $20.8 million in respect of capital deal. This is detailed in the tables attached to this statement, Mr. Speaker. In terms of resource deal, the level of departmental underspend is a little higher than I would have envisaged given the budgetary challenges faced by departments during the course of the 2015-16 year. Although I recognise an element of the underspend relates to the allocations made from the Public Sector Transformation Fund for voluntary access schemes of the FES, where actual costs were often dependent upon the decisions of individuals and therefore, as members will understand, difficult to forecast. On capital deal, the total departmental underspend of $20.8 million comprises $9.5 million relating to conventional capital deal and $11.3 million relating to financial transactions capital, and we will come back to that particular issue. The level of underspend of financial transactions capital is indicative of the challenges associated with developing suitable schemes that can utilise this funding, which can only be used for the purpose of loans to our equity investment in the private sector. And I put out that challenge again. It was put out yesterday to members to find imaginative ways and innovative ways to use this financial transactions capital. I will move on to the implications for carry forward of resources next, Cheann Comhairle. The budget exchange carry forward is determined at block level. Therefore, account also needs to be taken of the various centrally held items that impact on the overall block position. The main component of these is the year-end overcommitment position, which, following the receipt of some additional Barnet consequentials and easements identified by departments, amounted to £9 million in respect of capital deal, with £9.2 million resource deal being held unallocated for carry forward. In terms of capital deal, an element of the departmental underspend related to projects funded by borrowing. As the actual level of borrowing drawn was reduced to take account of this, some £1.3 million of the departmental underspend is not included in the block underspend position. As a consequence of these adjustments, the Executive has marginally exceeded its conventional capital deal control by £0.8 million. In line with the budget exchange scheme rules, this will be deducted from our resource deal carry forward. Therefore, there will be no carry forward of conventional capital deal into 2016-17. However, the Executive can carry forward in full its underspend of FTC financial transactions capital, totaling £11.3 million. With respect to resource deal, the unallocated £9.2 million combined with lower than forecast RRI interest payments and a small increase in regional rate income has resulted in the carry forward of £56.1 million of resource deal into 2016-17. In conclusion, and most importantly, in relation to provisional outturn, Cheann Comhairle, no spending power has been lost to the Executive as a result of year-end underspends. As the tables show, there is an underspend of £11.5 million on ring-fenced resource deal, which would exceed the amount available for carry forward. However, as this may only be used for the non-cash costs relating to depreciation and impairments, it has no impact on the level of funding available for public services and is instead a technical accounting matter. As the Executive currently has ample funding for these non-cash costs, no additional benefit would be gained should it be possible to carry forward this amount. Whilst I remain concerned, and I said this yesterday and repeat it again, I remain concerned by the level of underspend and ring-fenced financial transactions capital, it is pleasing that no resources have been lost to the Executive and that significant resource deal can be carried forward under the budget exchange scheme to help address the many pressures in the June monitoring round. I will now turn to the June monitoring round of Cheann Comhairle. Before getting into the specifics of the monitoring round, I think it's worth highlighting that the Executive has secured £4.5 million from banking fines to establish an air ambulance service. And I know members right across this House called for that air ambulance service. This funding will be received over 3 years, and £1 million will be allocated to the Department of Health in this monitoring round. I think all members will agree that this is a welcome development that will greatly benefit our community, and I think it will be particularly welcome by those outside the City of Belfast. I would like now to turn to the specifics of the June monitoring round, starting with a number of adjustments relating to centrally held items. Cheann Comhairle, members may recall that Budget 2016-17 held £30 million of the funding previously identified for mitigating measures for tax credits pending results of Professor Evison's work on welfare reform mitigations. Professor Evison's report, as you know, recommended that the Executive should introduce measures costing £64 million in 2016-17. With £75 million having already been allocated to the Department of Communities, the £30 million held centrally is now available for reallocation. Updates to forecasts of regional rate income and interest payments and borrowing provided an additional £2.3 million, while the block grant adjustment in relation to air passenger duty being lower than provided for in the budget contributes a further £0.2 million. The Chancellor's 2016 March budget provided additional Barnet consequentials of £5.8 million resource deal and £3 million capital deal, which are now available for allocation. As I said out earlier, the Executive can now plan to carry forward £56.1 million resource deal and £11.3 million financial transactions capital under the BES, under the Budget Exchange Scheme. Of course, this amount is subject to review once departments have provided final outturn information based on their audited accounts. Any adjustments to the amount carried forward will be handled in a future monitoring round, Mr Speaker. Turning now to those central pressures of which members will be aware. In 2015-16, receipts from the carrier bag levy exceeded allocations to environmental programmes by £0.5 million. As receipts from the levy must be used to support environmental programmes, the Executive must now return £0.5 million to DERA for this purpose. The Executive must meet the cost of the May 2016 Assembly elections. This is currently estimated to be £5.3 million, and this amount to be transferred to the Northern Ireland Office. Adjustments will be made later in the year when final costs are confirmed at Cheann Comhairle. Under legislation, the salaries of statutory office holders are met directly from the NI Consolidated Fund. This includes the Northern Ireland Public Service Ombudsman, the Comptroller and Auditor General, the Land Tribunal and judicial salaries. However, the salary costs also show in the relative department's resource Dale budget, but as they are a direct charge on the NICF, on the Northern Consolidated Fund, these costs are funded centrally. The latest estimate indicates that an additional £1 million resource Dale funding will be required in this year, and this will be transferred to the relevant departments in this monitoring round. In total, taking into account the opening over commitment and other central issues noted above, resulted in £87.7 million of resource Dale, £3.2 million capital Dale being available before taking account of departmental reduced requirements. In relation to reduced requirements, departments declared reduced requirements in this monitoring round of £35.1 million resource Dale and £18.5 million capital Dale. Full details are provided in the tables provided with this statement. The most notable item on the resource Dale side is a reduction of £35 million from the Department of Communities in relation to welfare support measures, reflecting the outcome of the Avison review I mentioned earlier, and slippage in the rollout of welfare reforms, the welfare attack. Internal reallocations. Mr. Speaker, with changes to departmental structures and new ministers only taking up post in May 2016, there is clearly a risk that the departmental budgets for 2016-17 are not aligned to ministerial priorities within the new departments, and I think that's understandable. In that regard, the Executive agreed through the budget process that the first monitoring round of 16-17 should provide an opportunity for new ministers to realign their own 16-17 budget allocations. Ministers have therefore been afforded the opportunity in this monitoring round to move funding across spending areas without recourse to the Executive. New unit of service tables aligned to the June monitoring position and reflecting ministerial priorities are detailed in the tables accompanying this statement. Departments may also, for a number of reasons, seek to reclassify expenditure from resource to capital or vice versa. All such reclassifications need Executive approval, and these are shown in the tables accompanying this statement. Departments may also, subject to Department of Finance approval, seek to move budget between the ring-fenced and non-ring-fenced resource Dale categories. The impact of these moves is shown in the table detailing the ring-fenced resource Dale decision. All these adjustments impacted on the total amount of resources available to the Executive in this monitoring round. Once all of these issues were taken into account, the Executive had £126 million resource Dale and £17.7 million capital Dale available to allocate. Mr. Speaker, before turning to the mainstream allocations, there are a number of other important issues I would like to highlight to members, starting with ring-fenced financial transactions capital. After taking account of the carry-forward of £11.3 million of FTC from 15-16, the Executive has a total FTC budget of £124.8 million, £124.8 million this year. Of this, £58.8 million has been set aside for the planned investment fund. Departments have declared reduced requirements in this round of £11.4 million, while the Department for Communities has been allocated £5.5 million to support co-ownership housing, which I think is welcome news, in particular given the comments of Jonathan Bell yesterday and the concerns of all members here. This £5.5 million towards the co-ownership housing will contribute to delivering social and affordable homes over this mandate. As a consequence of these changes, the Executive exit this monitoring round with £17.2 million of financial transactions capital remaining unallocated. Our capacity to identify suitable projects that can spend the FTC available to us remains an area of concern, and I have therefore asked ministers to actively seek opportunities to utilise this funding through loans or equity investments in the private sector. Turning now to central funds. As part of Budget 16-17, the Executive set aside £14 million resource Dale and £15 million capital Dale in respect of delivering social change in this financial year. The Executive Office has now confirmed a range of allocations under the Delivering Social Change banner to be processed in this monitoring round. £13.8 million resource and £6 million capital to the Executive Office for various social investment fund and delivering social change projects. I think that will cheer everyone. £1.6 million resource and £0.7 million capital to the Department of Health for the Bright Start School Age Children Scheme and delivering social change. £0.3 million resource to the Department of Education for Bright Start Childcare. I think all those will be welcomed across the House. The Executive has also agreed to the transfer of £1.7 million from the Atlantic Philanthropies Fund to the DSC programme to provide sufficient funding for all of the allocations detailed. Any time we mention Atlantic Philanthropies and our generosity towards this government, we should also salute the great Irish-American philanthropist Chuck Feeney, Cheann Comhairle. The Executive also agreed to transfer £0.4 million capital Dale from DSC to the Shared Future programme. Following these allocations, there is now £7.9 million capital Dale and no resource Dale unallocated relating to the Delivering Social Change programme. Budget 16-17 set aside £8 million resource deal for the Atlantic Philanthropies programme, which I referenced. The Executive Office has advised that the following allocation should be processed in this monitoring round: £3.6 million resource to health for the early intervention and dementia programmes. Taking account of the transfer to the Delivering Social Change programme, this means there is now £2.6 million resource deal remaining in the Atlantic Philanthropies Fund. Colleagues will recall that in Budget 2016-17, the Executive set aside £7.1 million resource deal for a change fund, including £1.5 million for estate rationalisation led by the Estate Management Unit in conjunction with the Reform of Property Management programme in the Department of Finance. A further £4.5 million was set aside for cross-cutting reform projects and £1.1 million for a pilot Small Business Research Initiative Challenge Fund. I can now report that all of this funding has been allocated to departments in this monitoring round. Mr. Speaker, the Fresh Start Agreement secured £60 million over 5 years to support creation of a shared future. The Executive's Budget 2016-17 set aside £12 million resource deal in this year, and the Executive Office has advised the following allocation should be processed in this monitoring round: £7.4 million to the Executive Office to cover a wide range of shared future measures, £1.5 million to education for summer camps and shared education campuses, £1.5 million to communities for shared housing and cross-community sporting events, £1.1 million resource deal, and £0.4 million capital deal to the Department of Justice for removal of interface barriers. All good news, Concordia. My officials will engage with Treasury in securing access to this funding through the Westminster supplementary estimates. Following these adjustments, £0.5 million of the funding available for a shared future remains all allocated. The Department of Justice has been provided with a requested £0.8 million resource and £0.5 million capital from the funding provided by the Executive to progress measures to tackle paramilitary activity. This will fund the cost of a three-person panel and supporting secretariat, a Fresh Start implementation team, a publicity campaign and the purchase of a specialist forensic science equipment. Turning now to other allocations in the June monitoring round. Allocations totaling £140 million.1 resource deal and £29.1 million capital deal have been agreed. The individual allocations are detailed in the tables and include £67 million resource deal to the Department of Health. That brings the total additional funding provided to health in 2016-17 to £200 million. I think in anyone's language, Mr. Speaker, that's a significant commitment to health. However, as we are all aware and has been repeated across the House from all sides, continually providing additional funding to health does not address the underlying issues. Therefore, it's vital that the reforms identified as a result of the work led by Professor Bungoa are implemented. The Executive has agreed to support the Health Minister in delivering substantial reforms to our health service. £30 million resource deal to the Department of Education. This is comprised of £20 million for schools in line with the commitment provided to the previous Education Minister by my predecessor. A further £5 million for special education needs, which I referenced at the start of the debate or statement, and £5 million for drawdown of school surpluses under the school's EYS scheme. £25 million resource deal to the Department for the Economy. This is comprised of £20 million for skills in line with the commitment provided to the previous Minister for Employment and Learning by my predecessor. That's three commitments in a row kept. A further £5 million for drawdown of FE College surpluses under the FE College End-Year Flexibility Scheme. £8.3 million resource deal to the Department of Communities to cover a number of pressures, including £4.3 million for maternity grants and funeral loans. It also includes, and I'm very proud and pleased with this, it includes £2 million to honour the commitment in the Fresh Start Agreement for welfare advice centres. This will help those most in need to receive their full benefit entitlement. The remaining £2 million will be used to address other inescapable pressures within the department, such as the D rating grant. There's a £1.5 million resource deal to DERA for the Knowledge Transfer Scheme to address the skills gap in the farming sector. There's £3 million resource deal to the Department for Justice for a number of central pressures. There's £5.3 million resource deal to the Department for Infrastructure for roads maintenance and flood prevention, another issue which came up yesterday. On capital deal, and I know members will welcome this, the Department for Infrastructure will receive £22.9 million, with the majority going to improve our roads infrastructure. Flood prevention and Waterways Ireland are also to receive allocations. The Department of Health will also receive £5 million capital deal. Each year, the hearing of approximately 20,000 babies is screened here, with around 450 babies requiring referral to diagnostic audiology services. This funding will provide a robust mechanism for recording results of these tests, ensuring that the right treatment is provided to babies where that is necessary. It will also enhance the communication systems between ambulance control and crews, providing for a more reliable 999 responses. I have spoken at committee and in the media several times since my election about the importance I place on the regeneration of border regions, which are often on the periphery of two economies. Cross-border cooperation, however, puts those same communities at the heart of the all-island economy. That's why I'm proud to be the First Minister since 2010 to make a capital allocation to a cross-border body in a monitoring round. On Friday past, I visited the headquarters of Waterways Ireland, met the amazing team leading Waterways Ireland, saw the transformational work they are involved in to make the Lough Erne waterway a beacon for tourism. With 6,000 boats on the Erne, Waterways Ireland is on the cusp of creating the most outstanding blue way in Europe, which will boost tourism, create jobs and revive the border region. I'm allocating $1.4 million to the Department for Infrastructure, which will assist Waterways Ireland with their bold capital investment plans. I have also provided the Department for the Economy with £1.3 million to complete the HMS Caroline Museum project, which will also boost our tourism sector. This project, and I was there at the launch, benefited hugely from big lottery money. We need to complete that project if it's to fulfil its tourism potential, so I'm pleased to make that allocation also. Ring-fence Resourcedale is strictly controlled and funding cannot be moved out of this area. Changes to this area are shown in the tables accompanying this statement. Colleagues will note that we exit this monitoring round with $15.6 million of ring-fenced Resourcedale unallocated. This funding may only be used to address pressures within the ring-fence depreciation impairments. It is therefore not available for allocation by the Executive. Before concluding, Cheann Comhairle, I would like to update members on the Public Sector Transformation Fund. Colleagues will recall that in Budget 2016-17, the Executive agreed allocations totalling $117.8 million, including $84.7 million for voluntary exit schemes and $33.1 million to restructure the teaching workforce. The Executive also agreed to £25 million of the £200 million available to the Public Sector Transformation Fund in 2016-17 should be used for capital projects, leaving some £57.4 million available for allocation through the 2016-17 in-year monitoring process. The Public Sector Reform Division has over recent months liaised with departments to identify easements on allocations agreed in the budget and any new allocations to schemes with capacity to deliver further savings for the Executive's budget. Changes to allocations in this monitoring round under the Public Sector Transformation Fund are detailed in the tables accompanying this statement. As a result of the allocations detailed above, we exit this monitoring round with a $13.5 million overcommitment in respect of Resourcedale and $11.4 million on capital there. Mr. Speaker, in this House earlier this year, we had a lengthy debate around the renewable heat incentive scheme and the problems with that scheme. Members who were there at the time, or perhaps read about it in the media, or who were here at the time and have been returned, they'll be aware that there's a potential additional Resourcedale pressure exists in relation to commitments under the renewable heat incentive. I'm not proposing an allocation to the Department for the Economy in this round, as the Executive has determined that every effort is made to reduce this pressure. I would ask members to support any measures brought before them that would help mitigate against what would otherwise be a considerable ongoing pressure on the Executive's Dale. I would also like to assure members that this potential pressure has been considered when developing these monitoring round proposals, and I am content it can be managed within our own Dale controls. Before I conclude, I'd also like to make members aware that the Executive has agreed a draft timetable and approach for the upcoming budget, which will set Resourcedale plans up to 2019-20 and Capital Dale, of course, to 2020-2021. It will come as no surprise that there are a number of strategic issues facing the Executive over this period, and not least the need to work in parallel with the programme for government process to allow the budget to support the Executive's priorities while ensuring that those aims are realistic within the overall funding envelope. In light of this, the Executive has agreed that Department of Finance officials will work closely with departments over the summer to form a view on the level of funding each department requires. In conclusion, and this is the conclusion of Cheann Comhairle, as I said at the start of this statement, I am strongly opposed, and we will hear later today, to the austerity of the agenda and the constraints it inflicts and imposes upon this Assembly. I will continue to fight against austerity at all levels, and alongside that I will seek to develop innovative funding options. However, despite the constraints inflicted upon us, I am pleased that this June monitoring round reflects a position outcome with additional positive outcome, additional funding being provided to key public services, if I get my sums right, around £170 million in funding for our departments. This monitoring round has delivered extra resources for health, education, skills, roads, housing, welfare and tourism. Marshin, a Cheann Comhairle, Boilam, and Bouta Monitor Act of Shaw, Augustin Reicher Shaw, a Wolloot and Chunnel. I commend the June monitoring outcome to the Assembly.
Call Mr. Philip Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Minister has said that today's statement is significantly different from previous monitoring rounds, and he is right in that this Assembly used to be informed not only of allocations but also the bids. Looking at his statement today, there is no indication whatsoever of what pressures departments had identified and bid for. Can the Minister explain why this information was left out of today's statement? And can he give a commitment that after today's proceedings he will circulate it to the House?
I think it's appropriate for Mr. Smith maybe to take up the points he said earlier in an attempt to delay this statement. I think I'm the first Minister to go in and see the Finance Committee, maybe simultaneously with the Executive Ministers. I intend to have a very collegial and honest engagement with Assembly members from all parties. This morning I became the first Minister in some time to brief the Chair and Deputy Chair. My predecessors, God bless them, briefed only the Chair on these matters. I intend to stay with that tradition of seeing the Committee often, seeing the Chair and Deputy Chair. But I will say this. This is the choice you have made. We want to have an effective, streamlined, efficient government delivering for all our people. You want to be in an opposition which is in the back seat. You want to drive from the back seat. You want to hold progress up. Our intention, Frio Las Concordia, is to make sure we do things. We deliver the actions. We do the deeds. Others may be strong in words, but this government is going to be very strong in deeds moving forward. But you're going to be assured of this. The Assembly and the Committee will have my full cooperation, but you cannot hold back progress. Scrutinise, challenge certainly, but let's move forward. People want us to make progress swiftly.
Well, Ms. Emma Little-Pengelly, Chair of the Finance Committee.
Madam Principal, Deputy Speaker, I'd like to thank the Minister for this very strong statement this morning, and in particular the swift agreement by the Northern Ireland Executive on June monitoring. I particularly welcome the additional £67 million to health, along with the increase at the beginning of this budget period of an additional £133 million. This does meet the commitment of the Executive to that £200 million additional each year. As the Minister will be aware, and we've discussed this already, much more is required than just resources to put health on a sustainable footing. Transformation is required, and I notice from his statement that there's £69 million of unallocated financial transactions capital and £59 million unallocated in public sector transformation fund. Would the Minister give a commitment to work with and work constructively with the committee in terms of looking at those unallocated funds and opportunities around funding and initiatives in order to bring about the necessary transformation to put health on a sustainable footing?
Committee Chair, thank you for your last concordia. Look, you can take it that this is work. This isn't a spectator sport. You're right. There are parties in government, those in opposition. But I think ideas on how we be more efficient in delivery of services should come from all sides. And it cheers me that actually we've reached a space in this, in a place in this House where people are not saying the solution to the pressures our society faces, our community faces, is always to spend more money. I think we all agree on health that the solution is to have better outcomes, to use our money wisely, and to adopt the Bengoa proposals. And that, in many ways, is depoliticising health. So, on all the matters that you raise, and in terms of cooperation and making sure we get the biggest bang for our buck, you can ensure that I will work positively with colleagues. Good morning.
Sir, John O'Dowd. I call John O'Dowd.
And I agree with the Minister that the public out there are more interested in product than they are in process, and they want to see changes being delivered to our society. Could I ask the Finance Minister if the monitoring rounds are going to form part of a strategic delivery of product to our people out there, and they're going to be form part of a budgetary process to see resources being directed to where those resources are required?
Well, Gordon, I got a quote. Éadaim leat go hiomlán maidir le tarraige seachas process. I agree with you entirely in terms of delivery and product rather than process. This was not a horse trading exercise. We have a positive government with the DUP and Sinn Féin and with Claire Sugden as Minister for Justice. We didn't engage in the whoosh lists that I have seen in previous governments where ministers put in bids which they know aren't realistic. We had a hard-headed negotiation with all the ministers. They understand, as I understand, we're all in this together. This is a holistic government. For years, people in here have complained about silo government and silo departments. This is a government acting with common purpose, moving forward together. So in that regard, the monitoring round has to fit in to our overall ambition for this government and for our people. It shouldn't be a wish list or horse trading or hoping that one department can get money denied to others. In fact, what I saw with ministerial colleagues in our private discussions was that they understood that if there's a greater priority, then you need to step back. If we need to finish a project, if we need to fund a project, and your department doesn't need it as much, you need to step back and say what is for the greater good. So this is a government, I think, fueled and with common purpose, and which shows by this monitoring round that we are intent to deliver. But I take entirely on board what you say, and this has to be part of our strategic approach. So it's early days. This, I think, is a good outcome for us today. We've managed to allocate £175 million. We've made a significant difference, but let's keep up the good work. Let's keep our shoulder to the wheel, because we need to repeat this later in the year, not only in relation to the budget coming up for 17-20 for the source and 17-21 for capital, but also in other monitoring rounds.
Sir Claire Hannah, I call Claire Hannah.
Speaker, we appreciate the Minister's energy, but we do support the view that there hasn't been sufficient time to scrutinise this. The first big report of this mandate was the paramilitary report. The First Minister's completely bypassed the Assembly on that occasion. At least you have taken questions, but 1 hour for members to scrutinise isn't sufficient. I'm looking at a couple of the figures here. Despite having significantly reduced powers in this mandate, £19.2 million has been allocated to the Executive Office for Social Investment Fund and Delivering Social Change, and a further £7.4 million for shared future measures, as well as money that's gone to other departments for the same purpose. Could the Minister clarify what that shared future measures money for the Executive Office will be spent on? Could I further get clarity on one other item? On page 6, you refer to a £126.2 million resource dell and £17.7 million capital dell, and on page 8 it refers to £140.1 million resource dell and £29.1 million capital dell. Could you just outline the reason for the discrepancy in those figures?
Can I remind members that there's one question allowed? But
I want to thank the member and thank her for attending the briefing this morning. And she's right, I do have some sympathy. I do have some sympathy, but the sympathy I felt for Mr Nesbitt yesterday is the 138 pages of estimates. But we need to make government work for the people. And there is a chance now to look at what we have done and to comment upon it, and you're welcome to do that. The figures are right, and I'm happy for you to drill down on the figures. But I want to say this. This is the second time in 2 days that the Social Investment Fund has been attacked and introduced in this chamber. And I'm going to read again where the Social Investment Fund is making a difference. And those who are trying to pillory the efforts of working class communities, especially in Tocmone and Sandy Row, because that's where the target has been, need to visit those communities, need to meet the heroes and pioneers who are trying to build up those communities which have not received an adequate peace dividend, whether it's Tigers Bay or the Market or the New Lodge. And I'm going to read again, if you'll ask Concordia, with your permission, some of what the Social Investment Fund has done. Bryson Street surgery, and people know that was a very difficult interface. The Social Investment Fund provided £1 million to make that happen. Increasing, and of course, build complete and operational. Increasing community services, best of the East Visitor Centre. Who isn't proud of the marvellous work being carried out by our friends in Eastside Arts and the East Belfast Partnership? Build complete to commence operations in coming weeks. I think it has commenced operations, because I know I've had some friends visited. Increasing community services, £1.7 million. Finvoy Street, Greenway, Belfast, Castlereagh Street. Again, another marvellous result from the Social Investment Fund. Increasing community services, £99K, Short Strand Community Centre, letter of offer issued. And it goes on, and it's being delivered. Was it too slow for my liking? Yes, it absolutely was too slow. And I'm determined as Finance Minister to be swifter. But when we are swifter with the Social Investment Fund, I hope people don't come to this house and say, it's too fast. You're getting the money into the communities to rebuild communities and transform lives too quickly. Because for me, that is very much our job. If I can just ask, the shared future goes through the Executive Office to other departments. The District Council's Good Relations Programme will be £0.6 million. The summer interventions will be £0.11 million. The Centre Good Relations Fund is $3 million. Summer camps is 0.2. And actually, I'll do what I did yesterday for the member. I'll email her this later. Well, then I'll have to read this. I'll continue to read. Urban villages is 0.7. Urban villages is 1.6. Contested spaces is 0.2. Together building united communities, shared future promotion publicity, 0.03, that's 30,000. Shared future staffing, urban villages, 0.149. I think members maybe would, I think we'll leave it like that, but I could go through the whole list.
Can I remind members to make all the remarks through the chair? And I call Stephen Farry.
Thank you, Madam Principal, Deputy Speaker. Can I congratulate the Minister on his efficiency with regard to the due monitoring statement? I'd also say that I don't believe any procedures have been broken in the manner which has been brought to us today, but I do think there's a genuine issue around transparency, around the full pressures being faced across government departments. Hopefully the Minister can rectify that gap. Can I ask him in relation to the additional money for skills, and obviously welcome his following through with the commitment made by his predecessor. Does the Minister recognise that that $20 million will only avoid further cuts happening on an in-year basis? And if we are to see a proper investment in the transformation of our economy in terms of future budget rounds, there does need to be a further ramping up in terms of investment in skills across apprenticeships, FE colleges and indeed our universities. I would also recognise and clarify if that $20 million is to be baselined, as was the intent by his predecessor in his correspondence to me in my previous role.
Well, if you will ask Corleop, when we have heard done well, done cold this in question occur. I thought that the former minister might have more of a smile this morning. I'm disappointed to see the glass is still half full, because when Mervyn Storey left those IOUs, I wasn't obliged to honour them. But I thought it was important to do so. I think you're absolutely right about the need to invest in higher education. I think you're absolutely right to point out that we can't really build for corporation tax if we don't have a strong tertiary level education system delivering first class graduates. This is my first bite at this particular chair. I have tried to honour your commitment. I've met both the VCs, both Vice Chancellors, Paddy Johnston and Paddy Nixon, one in Derry, one in Queen's University. You know they make a strong case. You know it's a cogent and logical case. But we don't have money to do everything we want to do. So I don't want to promise farther than what we've done today. The $20 million, of course, isn't only for universities. I'm a big fan of the Belfast Met and the other community colleges, I suppose you would call them, and they have to get some money from this as well. But I think that the member should be content that even though he's left the post, I think the thrust of what you wanted is being delivered. There's much, much more to do, but I understand the vital importance of third-level education to the success of this community, and I want to make sure as many people as possible can access a third-level education.
There's no interventions during questions to a statement. So can the member resume his seat? Thank you. But the member will have opportunities for questions.
And I think Eamon was going to mention McGee, so we might get to that as well. But anyway, I do believe, as was said previously, access to universities should be based on what your ability to learn, not on your ability to pay. And I commend the stance the minister took previously. Maybe he didn't get the funding to when he wanted it, but I think we're on a different trajectory now, and I hope this is the start of continued investment in building up our universities and further education colleges.
I call Paul Gervin.
Just welcome the statement this morning, and just want to thank the Minister for it. In relation to the capital and the resource to infrastructure, I appreciate that there is two amounts there that have been set aside for it. Was the road maintenance budget, which has been cut within the projected budget already of this year, and it's something which each and every one of us have concerns over. I think the maintenance budget is $5.3 million. I would like to have some more clarification. Was there any bid in relation to additional monies for the maintenance budget for the forthcoming year?
Well, if you'll ask me, I want to thank the member for his question as well. I think your interest in roads, and it was referenced yesterday, is twofold. One, we want to have efficient, capable roads that are possible, that we can be proud of, that we can drive on. But also your concern about the construction industry and making sure, I suppose, that those many jobs, and we see them every day, people who are out maintaining our roads, that they still have work available, and we release the budgets. I can tell you that when I met all my ministerial colleagues, all of them wanted more at first cut, but after mature discussions, the bids from departments by and large were realised, by and large. And I think you'll find, and I'm sure the Minister for Infrastructure will speak about this, you'll find that this will make a significant difference in the year to the amount of repairs we do on our roads. It's not really very wise policy to have potholes and then people claim against the government and we lose money on it, but you'll find this will make a significant difference in the time ahead. I don't know if it will cheer you entirely, but I think you'll find it will make a significant difference.
Éireann Sir Barry McElduff. I call Barry McElduff.
I've got free of last time call. Agus ta cash dugum ta mulluagum don Ira. Can I encourage the Finance Minister to continue, where possible, to support early intervention programmes and special needs programmes in respect of education? And just to seek an assurance from the Minister that he and the Education Minister will be supportive and give a good listening ear to school principals who at this time feel under pressure with additional pressures in the school budgets. And just to say as well that I do appreciate the financial constraints imposed on the Minister by the Westminster cuts.
Well, if you'll ask Corley, when we have worked on Cole, as in case she occurred, as Ambassador Liger, her son, and Idiahish, August Tasung will. Jack Hydry, the Priowidji, the Munchery, the Tushji, the member is a strong ambassador for increased investment in education and is always carrying the standard for principals, for the school teachers, and for parents and for the children. I'm pleased that we've been able to make an allocation to the schools, additional allocation to the schools. I'm a supporter of the Bright Start programme, but what I would say is that the discussion now in relation to how the money will be used is one with the Education Minister, but Peter Weir. But you can be sure the views of the member and my views are perfectly aligned. We understand the importance of early intervention, making sure that all children have a great opportunity in life, and it has to start very early. And I'm heartened not only by the passion of the advocacy by educationalists and by parents, but I'm heartened also that across the chamber, members from all parties agree that education is a priority. And when we never have enough money to do everything we want to do, I think it's fair to say that we understand where the priorities are. And that's why there's extra money in this, not only for education, but also for special educational needs. I want to make sure that we reinforce the delivery of initiatives such as Pathways, and I wish the Education Minister well as he endeavours to make sure we make an even greater positive impact with our young people.
Paul Jim Wells.
I'm sure the Minister will accept that he's building on the strong foundation laid by his predecessors, Mr Hamilton and Mr Storey, and Mr, of course Mr Wilson. And I'm sure he'll also... And Mrs Foster, yes. And Mr Robinson and Mr Dodds. but will he accept, as my colleague has already said, that whilst the monitoring round improvements in funding for road maintenance are indeed welcome, that if we don't, through either monitoring round or better funding in the main budget, deal with the situation soon, we are storing up huge problems for ourselves in the future, in that if we don't start to maintain our roads, in 20 or 30 years' time, we will have a vast expenditure because we're going to have to fundamentally rebuild them.
Yeah, well, I do, Mr Wells. I think you forgot Finance Minister Durkin. Maybe that goes back. It doesn't go back before your time. It certainly goes back before the time of many members here, but I think you were here for that period as well. I think you're absolutely right. Penny wise, pound foolish. We need to invest in our roads infrastructure. We need to get this right. It's important that as we do face constraints that we don't ignore investment, and we don't, because if we do, what will happen is that a year down the road or 2 years down the road, we're landed with a huge financial headache. So we take that on board. It has been a position voiced by many members, not only the roads in Belfast, but the rural roads as well and the minor roads. We need to make sure that we invest in this network. It's important for our people, it's important for the success of our society, it's important for tourism, it's important for visitors. So your point is well made, and I hope to learn. I think it's fair to say that each of the finance ministers you mentioned, whatever be the finance minister I mentioned, that's before my time, they're all prudent. They all were aware of the pressures which impose upon our spending, and I think that they always try to act in a wise and prudent fashion, and I intend to do the same to make sure that there's no neglect of investment, which will create at a later date a headache for us.
I call Robin Swan.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, you mentioned the renewable heat incentive and asked members to support any pressure brought before them because you haven't made a bid in this monitoring round. Can you therefore give us guidance as to what the timescale is on those measures that are going to be brought, and also see you're content that any pressures can be managed within your current Dell controls?
Well, I want to thank the member for his question. I think, Robin, you were here for the debate on the renewable heat incentive. I think you know that I was, like other members, very energised by the way the scheme was operated. It's clear to me there are a number of flaws and fault lines in that scheme. I have pressed back hard on officials in relation to how we're going to rectify this problem. I don't want to make an allocation for it now, but I am preparing for an allocation if that's necessary. We need to study this carefully, but we also need to act rather swiftly, because until we rectify the problem, it will continue to gather pace. So of all the issues that I think we address in the time ahead, getting a handle on this renewable heat incentive, as they did in England, but they got a handle on it when they thought it was going to be an overspend. I think getting a handle on that is absolutely vital. I look forward to my colleague Simon Hamilton coming forward with proposals, but I know he's equally energised about this issue, and I know he is focused on finding a resolution and coming to the Assembly as early as possible, and to me with a strategy for dealing with the problem. But it's not a secret to members, because we did discuss it at length, that it has not been a well-run scheme, and I do look forward to Minister Hamilton bringing forward his proposals.
Sir Sinead Bradley. I call Sinead Bradley.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Firstly, I would like to say, like others, I obviously haven't had sufficient time to read in great detail the report, but I do welcome, and I do welcome some of the headline figures there, if you like. Particularly, I welcome news that there will be funding for roads, and I will be watching carefully to see how that funding is allocated regionally. I know in particular there's a need in South Down for possibly more tarmac than others. Certainly, yes. I also welcome the Waterways Ireland. There, up until now, a real danger of some of these cross-border bodies withering on the vine, because they have not had adequate funding or support. The Minister did comment that he's had...
Can the Member ask her question, please?
Yes, thank you. He did mention that during frank discussions with the Executive, they possibly will have to set aside some projects. Given this renewed commitment to cross-border bodies, I would hope that the Minister could give an assurance that Narrow Water Bridge project has not been set aside as one of those projects, and given his commitment now to cross-border projects, he could give that assurance to the people of South Down. Thank you.
Before I call the Minister, can I remind members that this is a question to the Minister, not a statement. So can I ask members to have their questions brief?
I want to thank Ms Bradley for her question. I think she's right to focus on rural roads. Those of us from Belfast are accused occasionally of forgetting there is anywhere outside the city limits. So I intend to do that. You're fortunate in that I think Chris Hazard doesn't live too far away, so he can certainly visit and view those roads with you. In terms of Waterways Ireland, I'm happy to, I think part of that maybe in your constituency or it's part of the Ulster Canal, and I'm happy to visit that and look at that with you to see how we might progress that project, which is another example of a project that's been around too long that we haven't delivered on. As governments, we haven't delivered on, and yet I think it's a transformational project. In fact, as Geoffrey Donaldson reminds me, if we can get from Belfast to Lough Neagh and then get to Shannon, and we'll have an all-island new highway or an old highway reopened. So I'm with you on that entirely. It is a statement of intent. I have to work with other ministers, of course, but do I believe it's the benefit of all our people, as Sir George Quigley believed, to develop an all-island economy? Yes, I do. Do I believe that the communities in the border region are on the periphery of two economies, but yet they could be at the centre of an all-island economy? Yes, I do. Do I believe that the border communities, I know you represent some of those, that they deserve a bigger slice of the peace dividend? Yes, I do. So you will find me an ally for any proposals around constructive cross-border cooperation, which encourages the all-island economy, which encourages cooperation between our communities and our peoples in the time ahead. In terms of Narrow Water, I remain a fan of that project. As I said to the committee last week, I generally support bridge building. I think it's a good way to move forward. I have looked on that. I saw this project before I was returned to this house, and I will be working with yourself and with other members to realise that dream of having a bridge at Narrow Water. So the work starts. It's not, of course, my department, but you can be sure that it's a project which I think is a priority and hope to see it realised in the time ahead. And the time ahead sometimes in this House means a long, long time, but I hope it's a project we can get stuck into.
Paul Stuart Dixon.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, thank you for your statement. Can we return to the renewable heat incentive? And can you give us an assurance that this matter, regardless of the sums involved, will be dealt with directly and by the Executive rather than left to the Department of the Economy, whose sole role should be to transform our economy and not be burdened in this respect? So can he give the House an absolute assurance that this matter will be dealt with directly by the Executive?
I thank the member for his question, and you were in for the debate earlier this year, and I think it is one of the most vital and pressing issues that face us at this time. I think it's the right decision to move it to the centre. I am looking forward to seeing proposals. It is our friends in the energy section of data who will be dealing with this and are dealing with it on a daily basis, but I think it's a crucial question, vital question. I've moved the allocation are to the standard if it's necessary, and you can take it that wherever it sits, it's a priority for me to get a handle on this and to make sure we have a solution.
Called Steve Aiken.
Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, may I say to the Minister, apologies for not having had the chance to go through this forensically, as I know as I would like to do to be able to achieve this. But there are a couple of questions that come out with it I would quite like answers if he would have the opportunity to do so. As we notice that despite the increase in £25 million, much of it which will go to restoring part of the issues to do with the skills shortage we have in Northern Ireland. I note from the Ring Fence Resource Dell there's a reduction of £34.2 million, and again we haven't seen those figures and we would like to see the reasoning behind those figures fairly soon. On the second issue, I would particularly like an issue again.
That it's one question to the Minister.
So then in that case, I shall sit down. Thank you.
Well, it's a matter of great disappointment that you've had 15 minutes and you haven't forensically examined all those figures, Mr. Aiken, because I know you're well capable of it. I don't have the full reasons for that fall. I didn't realise it was a fall. I'm not sure which department you're referring to, but happy to discuss that with you. Overall, I think it's a good monitoring round. Many of the issues which have been brought up by the opposition since I came in here are addressed as well. And you know these issues are priorities for the government parties, but the reality is that some of the big issues we have addressed here were brought up by my colleagues in the opposition parties yesterday. And I think we can all stand over that. So your priorities, I think, are addressed in this monitoring round, and I think that is a reason to welcome the monitoring round. There will be an opportunity with individual ministers or with me, if you wish, to go through each reason for slippage or underspend, but there will be all sorts of reasons for this, and some of them can be very genuine in relation to welfare mitigations. Of course, that hasn't moved ahead as swiftly as was thought, thank God. So there's some money returned to the centre. There are some Barnett consequentials as well. But I think that each department, when I went back to departments and said, well, why are you not spending the money? It didn't seem to me to be inefficiency. It seemed to be other factors at play, and it was, in my view, justifiable and correct that they should surrender the money to be reallocated. But happy to pour over the figures with you at a later date.
Eirim Sir Nicola Mallon. I call Nicola Mallon.
Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. The Minister has made much reference to the importance of delivering on actions, and yesterday I welcomed the fact that he said that housing is a priority for him. Can I ask the Minister that, considering there are some 40,000 households on the waiting list, 22,000 of which are in housing stress, how many affordable homes and social homes will be built from this allocation? And in light of the fact for our most vulnerable people, a roof over your head is important, but also critically important is wraparound services. Can I ask the Minister where the funding is, for example, for projects like supporting people and the Housing First model?
Well, Stephen Farrell's glass was half full. I think, Ms. Mann, your glass is about a third full. There was no indication in any of the media reports before this announcement that there would be anything here, but I think one member of my esteemed colleagues in the Lands Party with the unravelling of budgets. Mr. Atwood talked yesterday about urgent statements to the House about the budget situation. In fact, this is a very positive outcome across departments, but in particular for co-ownership housing. We have managed, and I have said this candidly to members, we need to come up with more ways to spend this financial transaction capital. But we have managed to find $5.5 million for the co-ownership scheme. Those will be for social and affordable homes. It's not the preference of everyone. It may not suit some of the people we're talking about. But it is my intention, and we talked about priorities, it is my intention to provide the funding where I can, or to ensure that we have found ways to raise and to borrow in a prudent fashion against a revenue delivering project to build the homes that we need. We have committed before the election, we Sinn Féin committed to building 10,000 new homes. But that, even that isn't enough, because, as I said yesterday, you can't have a family if you don't have a home. And the figures, while they are really worrying, they are an indictment, I think, of our society, the level of housing stress and homelessness. I think we need to make a start and tackle it. That's why I welcomed the $280 million from the European Investment Bank last week for two of our housing associations, APACs and Choice, I think. And that's why I will make a priority, if the Minister for the Communities comes to me with other proposals about enhancing support for the homeless and for those seeking homes, I will be very sympathetic. Nothing is more important, nothing is a greater test of our ability and efficiency as a government than delivering homes. So we have made some progress. $5.5 million isn't enough. And the member can work out herself what she thinks that will deliver in terms of homes at the cost of them. $280 million, I think, from EIB isn't enough. We need to find a way to allow the housing executive to borrow off balance sheet so they can get on with what they're good at, which is building homes and making them available to families. So what I will say is that if she, in the time ahead, wants to prioritise housing, especially housing the homeless, I suggest she brings that robustly to Minister for the Communities, but she will find me an ally and a very sympathetic ear. So if she works in concert with the Minister of Communities in relation to housing, she will find that I will be very supportive of doing what we can in the time ahead in relation to easing housing need.
Called Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. Can I also thank the Minister for her statement, and, like others, welcome the additional £72 million being allocated to the Department of Health. But equally, I welcome the realisation from the Minister in his statement that this does not address the underlying issues. He will remember I touched on this in my contributions yesterday. So can I ask, what guarantees can the Minister give that our health service actually has the capacity to use these additional multi-million pound allocations, and also the statement lacks clarity on what the £67 million resource and
question.
£5 million capital will be used for? So can the Minister break it down for us?
I call the Minister to answer one question of his choice.
Yeah. I thank Ms. Dobson for prioritising health again and focusing on health. And again, reiterating what everyone is saying, that while this additional money is very welcome, it brings to 200 million the amount extra we have allocated to health this year, that money alone is not the solution. I have honoured some of the commitments made by Simon Hamilton, the outgoing minister, to the health service. I have worked with my officials and with the health department officials to make sure that every penny of this is used. I will not be pleased if any department comes back and says the money that we bid for in June monitoring we didn't use or we couldn't use. It would be, I think it would be a bad marker to put down with me, because we really made sure the bids were realistic. We really worked hard with other ministers and other officials to make sure that the money really was needed and will be used. So in terms of how it will be used, demand for unscheduled care, new and unplanned attendances at emergency departments has increased, as you know, and you've highlighted, since 14-15. Funding is therefore required in a number of areas to improve patient care and unscheduled care, including winter pressures, a capacity expansion on acute sites and staffing within emergency departments. Key aspects of the social care system remain under significant pressure in 16-17, with additional investment required in domiciliary care and the statutory and independent sector, children's services, learning disability and psychological therapies. This allocation will help to address frontline pressures and improve patient flow. I'm happy to meet with you to talk in more detail where that's going, but I'm sure Michelle O'Neill, the Minister O'Neill, will be as well. But again, I'd say what I said in relation to housing. Please highlight housing, because it's not my department. Sorry, please highlight health. It's not my department, but as with housing, I want to remain an ally and advocate for wise and prudent spending, which really delivers better outcomes in health.
I would like to ask the Minister, of all the key spending areas, of the total amounts within those spending areas, how much of that comes from the EU as source?
Well, Boylan Bui has heard and called this, as in question occur in Yavi to Insakaihar War and Ishtati Araish Masna the Duatak. August Tasum called to a goal lesson, Kesha August Mullum and True would have to a goal foster. Augustato Giri Firiki. On Kaicha shop when in Chelis Narana Sogunya a wine, Chok Kaicha Sogunya. Ach gan eirus cúrthar leis an airgead ón Europe agus sin bhfuil gacéad 8 milliún I guess the UPB agus thart bhfuil gacéad 60 milliún ag Interreg. I welcome the member's question. I know where he's going on the question, and I applaud where he's going on the question. This is our expenditure. This is our departmental expenditure. But European funds are absolutely essential to the delivery of services. And in terms of SEUPB, members may correct me, I think it's around 280 million euro, and Interreg's around 260 million. And without that funding, without referencing Brexit, we would not be able to deliver the vast majority of the projects, which I know you're interested in rural areas and border areas, for example. So this is our commitment to the kitty. But without European funds, we would not be able to deliver the services which are so vital to our people. So your resolve, like my resolve, is to make sure that 24th of June those funds are still available.
I call Roy Beggs.
Deputy Speaker, and again I thank the Minister for his statement. But I must say I do find the new format unhelpful, and I'm concerned at the lack of transparency like others. But I believe it is healthy to be aware of the bids, the choices, and the pressures that were there. So can the Minister advise, in terms of the bids, were there bids to, for instance, provide additional capital funding to improve health centres, because there's an issue with it in my constituency, or in terms of education, resource funding to address some of the effective cuts to your schools? Were there any unsuccessful bids, and will the Minister publish all the bids?
I want to thank the member for his question. The bids in my negotiations and discussions with ministerial colleagues are, of course, confidential. But what I can say is this, that you always find at your first meeting with ministers that they do want the earth, the moon, and the skies, the stars. but we did have very realistic discussions very early on. This is a new style of government. It's not. I don't think it would have been the benefit to any health centre, to any school, to any community project to have unrealistic bids trawled through committees for a month, exercising all types of commentary and speculation, when it's much better, in my view, to have a government of common purpose, focused on a holistic response to all the pressures facing us, making realistic bids to me, discussing those with me, understanding then what their sister departments need, which never happened before, because before, of course, in the five-party government, it was every man and every woman to himself. So what I can say is that every minister, and this includes not only DUP but Sinn Féin, but also Clare Sugden, Minister for Justice, every minister left content, left realising that they would love more money, there's more they want to do, but there isn't enough money in the pot. And we will return. Some people, as you say, made strong case for perhaps issues which were of particular interest to them, which we couldn't meet at this time. So I'll return to those discussions with ministerial colleagues in the time ahead. But this streamlined, efficient style of government will make sure that we do deliver the type of project that you're talking about in the time ahead.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Principal Deputy Speaker, welcome the Minister's statement. And whilst the allocations to the Department of Infrastructure are welcome, will the Minister take steps to address the stop-start nature of funding, to address road repairs and defects in structural maintenance? And will he undertake to put in place proper financial planning and a proper system to ensure that adequate funds are allocated at the earliest point so that contractors and the road construction industry can properly plan, and that road maintenance is no longer treated as a political Cinderella?
Yeah, I want to thank Mr. Kennedy for that question. I would have thought you would have left a fairly healthy budget to Minister McElveen, and now it's coming to me, and that stop-start had not been a part of the department's approach. Certainly won't be part of my approach, and I agree with you entirely, not only for the construction industry, but for those who are wanting to see projects, and some projects which, Mr. Kennedy, some people may say were stop-start under your tenure, the A5 and the A6, for example. I want to deliver on those projects. We're very ambitious and bold ambition in relation to A5 and A6, and I want to deliver on them. I want to deliver in a strategic fashion. There are always difficulties. There may be, you know, a planning inquiry here. There may be a difficulty here. But I agree with you entirely. This needs to be a cogent, forceful, passionate approach to building up the road infrastructure that we need. Our people need that, who use the roads. Our economy needs that, and also our construction industry needs that. And I'll say this just finally, although the majority of the money I have allocated in this modern round is to do with road maintenance and so on. The A5 and the A6, occasionally people who meet me talk about the North West City region of Derry, or Londonderry, as you would say, Mr. Kennedy, and they talk about those people need to get to Belfast and or Dublin or wherever. And actually, what's really clear when you visit Derry, as I did last week, I met the Donegal Council CEO as well, is that the contribution they will make to the wider economy, the Derry and Donegal, by a proper transport infrastructure, will help all our people right across the country. And it's the enabling of that. It's the enabling of their contribution to us, which will be, I think, the real genius of the A5 and A6. And I know it didn't make as much progress as perhaps you would have liked under your tenure, but we make a commitment here that we will deliver in a consistent, informed, strategic fashion the roads infrastructure that our people need and which our economy requires.
I call Stephen Agnew.
Principal Deputy Speaker, previously the Minister made reference to the social investment funds and the benefits of it as he sees it. However, does he share my concern that there are those receiving SIF funding who wear the air of respectability by day but direct criminality by night, and who by night cause community tensions and by day seek funding to resolve them? What will the Minister do to ensure, where evidence of such practice exists, that public funding is withdrawn?
Well, you'll note I made an allocation towards paramilitary strategies to end paramilitarism. I doubt if and I know all members of the House will join me in this, I doubt there's any member in this House that endorses or condones a paramilitary activity. I know in your constituency there has been a series of worrying problems and concerns by ordinary people that that spectre of paramilitarism still lingers. You can take it from me that I stand four square behind the community of North Down, the community of South Belfast, the community of every constituency in facing down paramilitaries. But I want to say as well that I have worked with people who were former paramilitary leaders in Sandy Row in South Belfast, and I have found that every commitment they've made to me, they have kept. Every time I've asked them to keep the peace, they have done that. Every engagement I've had with them has been respectful. I believe they are committed to the path of peace and the path of building up their communities, and I will stand with them. If you, Mr Agnew, or anyone else has evidence of anyone involved in any of our programmes, and I'm not entirely sure about singling out the Social Investment Fund, I'm not sure that's very wise, but anywhere, because we spend money right across the piece, as you know, we should bring that to the PSNI and demand rapid and effective action against paramilitarism. We've come too far, to let anyone drag us back. So I'm going to set aside your singling out of Social Investment Fund. Maybe there's a project you want to bring to the attention of the police, the authorities. Please do so. But that to the side, I think I stand where you stand in terms of making sure we have societies free of paramilitary influence.
I call Jim Allister.
The Minister is very anxious to impress with the speed with which he brought this statement to the House. Certainly quicker than last year, because we never got a June monitoring round, and we all know the reason for that, because Sinn Féin was involved in a sham fight over welfare before it rolled over. Could I ask him specifically about a matter in Table 4? Now that he is a custodian, not just a spender, of public finance, is he satisfied that it is good value for money to have sold 621 acres at Shackleton for £1 million? Was that value for money for the taxpayer?
Well, I want to thank Mr. Alistair Gormaigat. This is the can't-do corner. It's not even a corner. It's only a small little redoubt in the Assembly. And I don't mind people who say you can't do. Most of the opposition are saying to me, you can do more, and you can do it faster and do it more efficiently. But I think it's refreshing to have a can't-do corner. And what I will do every time I hear from the can't-do corner is I will respond as positively as I can, because the can-do eventually, as proved by 107 members, the can-do eventually outnumbers, outshines, overshadows the can't-do. What I'll say to you about Shackleton is that, obviously, I didn't sell it. I'm 2.5 weeks in the post. But if you believe it wasn't value for money, if you believe what is proposed is not to the benefit of all our people, then raise that issue. Bring that issue to us. But I want to see our society move into a better place, a more prosperous place, move from a society which had at every turn symbols of division, symbols of the past. I'm not sure, Mr. Allister, you want to be there. I think you'd be very comfortable in the past. So for today, this is a monitoring round about the future. This is a can-do monitoring round. Will it be tested? Will there be challenges? Of course there will. This is not the be-all and end-all. But it's a step forward. I understand you would like to come back, but you'll have plenty of opportunities to come back, because we're going to be here for a while.
And I ask that all members make their remarks through the chair. I call Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. The Minister said in his earlier remarks that we are all in this together. A phrase which, of course, in recent years has been mainly associated with Mr. David Cameron, who repeats it at every occasion. As he puts the boot into the poor, he assures them, we are all in this together.
Has the member a question?
Yes, please. Indeed. I want to put that together with his statement, his suggestion that there are two vice-chancellors in the North, one in Belfast for Queen's, and, he said, one in Derry. This is not true.
Can the member
make
his
question? My point is this. I'm asking the Minister, will he, given assurance now, that the management of the University of Ulster have no need to and should now call to a halt the redundancy programme, which is closing courses at McGee, which is getting rid of lecturers in McGee. How can we listen to all the promises about the expansion of McGee when what they are actually doing is contracting McGee?
Hi, Corner, I don't know if there's a can't do corner, but then there's a can't hear corner. I mentioned British Prime Minister Cameron's reference to we're all in this together to denounce it and to say clearly that that's a lie and a canard. That's why I used the expression not to endorse it. So you have to listen to the entire sentence, the one before and the one after, but you can check the answer afterwards. I went to McGee last week, because I went to the University of Ulster at McGee because I want to state clearly at this early stage what I was told by the Chief Executive of Derry City Council, Derry and Strabane Council, what I was told by the Donegal County Council Chief Executive, what I was told by the business community, the Chamber of Commerce and others who I met before I left the city, and what I was told indeed by the Vice Chancellor, Paddy Nixon. That is that the entire success of the future of what I'm happy to call the North West City Region of Derry hinges on the success of the University of Ulster campus at McGee. I'm happy to see that numbers there have increased. I'm a big advocate. I've said this to my colleague and my friend, the Vice Chancellor of Queen's University, big advocate of anthropology, big advocate of the Irish language, big advocate of history. I have a degree in two out of those three subjects, not a very good degree, but I have a degree in two or three of those subjects. And I would like to see, and I've said this to all those involved in the universities, that I want to see those particular disciplines grow in the time ahead as well as other disciplines. So for me, the way to grow our universities is to provide the funding. We've just done that today. I don't know if the member heard that as well, maybe he missed that piece, but we've just provided $20 million to make the type of investment that Mr. Farrey had been calling for previously.
And that concludes questions and statement. The next item.